Hello.
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 Hello, my name is Matthew West, and I'm the host of this podcast. It's called the Matthew West Podcast. I really hope you like it.
Hello.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of the Matthew West Podcast. I'm your host, Matthew West, and as always, I really hope you like it. I'm your raspy voice host today, because I just had too much fun on the road this past weekend. And I mean, what an amazing time. We kicked things off on Wednesday this week, in Youngstown, Ohio. Then we went to Camp Hill, Pennsylvania, and finished out in the D.C. area in Haymarket, Virginia. Sold out shows. Had an absolute blast singing with every single one of you. That's why my voice is a little bit sore, because I was just having too much fun. And we took a week off from the podcast last week, unintentionally, but my allergies got the best of me. Felt like I needed to rest my voice so I could be ready for the shows. So those who tune in weekly to the podcast, please accept my sincerest apologies. I rarely miss a week. If you follow every week, you'd know that. So that is not like me to miss a week. But here I am. I'm back. And I'm back with stories to tell of an incredible weekend traveling across the country. And boy, the other night, I was singing Truth Be Told. And the crowd, that's one that the crowd seems to sing the loudest on. Ironically, it's also one of the songs that I don't even have any lyrics up on the screen for. So it's always makes for a really special moment, just the having a big old sing-along. There's something about that melody, too, that just feels very sing-along-y. But, you know, so many people have shared how that song's been meaningful to them. One thing I noticed, though, the other night was, and this was in Pennsylvania, there was one voice singing above everyone. And granted, again, this is a sold-out crowd, but I could hear one high-pitched voice singing louder than the rest of the entire crowd. And so when the song ended, I just made note of it. I just said, hey, you know, there's whoever it is that's singing louder than everybody else, I hear you. And everybody started pointing to this little girl as if they heard her too. And they highlighted her to me and pointed to her. And she stepped out into the aisle. And what happened next was pretty incredible. I motioned for her to come up to me and take a listen to what happened when she ran up to the front of the stage to meet me.
Was this girl?
There's no failure, no fight.
There's no thing you don't already know. Let the truth be told. Hug my dad.
Can I hug your dad? Dad, some dads don't like hugging.
But he's a really big fan of you, so I think it would be really nice if you could hug him.
Is he back here? Can you take me to him? Don't bother coming up here, sir. I'll just come up here and hug it out. Y'all make some noise for that sweet girl and her dad. More hugs? I'm getting all the hugs tonight. I'm feeling the love in Youngstown. Will you hug me? Okay. Just hug the person next to you if you want, huh? You guys should all feel this love. Man, this is awesome. Are we having a good time or what?
Is that amazing or what? That's awesome. We were hugging everybody. I hugged her dad. Big old dude with a hello my name is hat on. How sweet is that? I'm telling you, those are moments that even if I play that for you and you're listening to it now, you had to be there to really experience just how special that moment was. The fact that that sweet girl was thinking about her dad. Can you hug my dad? He's a big fan. I love it. I love hugging your guys' necks. I love hearing your stories. I love singing with you. I love coming out on the road. There's only a few chances left, by the way, to come and see me. You know, not ever, Lord willing, but this spring on the Don't Stop Praying tour. So head over to MatthewWest.com today if you haven't already recently, and check out what's going on over there. You can click on the tour button. You can find out where I'm going to be on the Don't Stop Praying tour. I'm also doing a special Palm Sunday concert in Dallas, Texas at First Baptist Dallas. All of our tour dates are up in 2024. We're going to have some more dates popping up. But bad news, Roanoke, Virginia is sold out. New Albany, Indiana is sold out. Joplin, Missouri is sold out. So there's actually only tickets available for three shows, and that would be Clarkston, Michigan has a few tickets available on March 15th, Lubbock, Texas on March 22nd, Houston, Texas on March 23rd. And then that's it for a little while, my friends. So you gotta get on it. Come and see me, Cochran and Company. We're having a blast. Hey, speaking of MatthewWest.com, have you seen the latest music video for Don't Stop Praying? You can watch it at my official YouTube page, or you can just click at MatthewWest.com. It's right on the front. But the other thing I wanted to share with you about is the brand new book. We are just days away from the release of My Story, Your Glory, and you can pre-order the book if you so choose to do. I sure hope you'll get a copy of this book. It comes out March 18th. If you click on the book section, you can pre-order the new book. It's a My Story, Your Glory. This is a 30-day devotional-style book, discovering the journey God has planned for you. Go to MatthewWest.com, click books, and you can order it wherever you like to order it, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Books A Million, whatever. You can also order, there's one location where you can order a signed copy, and I'll autograph it for you. $3.19, the book comes out, and if you redeem your order at my website, so wherever you order it, you come back and redeem your order at MatthewWest.com, you'll get access to a launch party that's happening on March 19th. So make sure that you do that. I can't tell you how excited I am for you to read this book. In the coming weeks, I'm going to share more about the heart behind the book. But in short, every chapter of this book, every day, 30 days, every day is an invitation and a challenge from me to you to invite God into your story, to really ask God to invade every part of your story and watch and be amazed how your life changes when you do that. So I can't wait for you to read it. I can't wait to hear how this book impacts your life. I wrote the book in a way that I hope to read devotional books, that I enjoy reading devotional books along with my quiet time. There's tons of scripture. There's some guided questions. There's some area for you to write your own notes, what the Lord's speaking to you about your story. So can you tell I'm just a little bit excited about it? Also, you might, if you listen to K-Love Radio, maybe you've heard me taking over K-Love Radio this week as a guest DJ, talking about the book. That's been a lot of fun. So thanks to my friends at K-Love for helping me promote the new book, My Story, Your Glory, available March 18th. You may be able to sneak an early copy if you come to see me on tour. But if you order it online, be sure to go back to MatthewWest.com, redeem your order, and get access to a launch party on March 19th, okay? My Story, Your Glory, 30-day devotional, coming your way. Hey, speaking of books, though, I got to tell you, I told you I played three concerts this weekend, and that's not entirely true. I actually did four as I take a drink of water. I did four concerts this weekend, even though I was only in three cities, and that's because when I was in Pennsylvania, I was just a mile down the road from the venue where I was performing was actually a maximum security prison. And I received an invitation from one of our ministry supporters who does work at the prison, ministry work there, actually bringing in therapy dogs to the inmates, which is a really cool ministry. Shout out to a woman named Zella who does that. The door opened for me to go into the prison and perform a concert for about 150 inmates inside the penitentiary in Pennsylvania. And it was an incredible experience, guys, as you might imagine. One of the things that I remember kind of struck me about the experience was they told me I couldn't bring, they were very specific about what I could bring in, what I couldn't bring. But one of the things that alarmed me was they wouldn't even let me bring my Bible in. Of course, it made me think of that scene in Shawshank Redemption where, you know, the main character, at the end of the movie, they find out he had hidden a little hammer in his Bible. So I thought, well, maybe that's why they wouldn't bring, you know, he used that little rock hammer to carve his way to freedom when he escaped from Shawshank, and he had hidden it in that Bible the whole time. So perhaps that's why they didn't let me bring my Bible. I don't know. But it was alarming, you know, because it's like, man, you're not even going to let me bring God's word in. But can I just tell you that when I got in the prison, and I got in front of the inmates, and I had my guitar, I started to realize the importance of memorizing God's word and hiding it in your heart, because it returns to you when you need it. And I realized that even though I didn't have a physical copy of my Bible, it was there in my head and in my heart. And I was able to quote one scripture of God's word after the other as I shared my testimony and my songs with the inmates. It was a really special time. And of course, you know, once I got inside the gates, I realized they had Bibles there as well. They didn't just have Bibles, though. Thanks to my ministry and great supporters of our ministry, Pop Wee, they had copies of my last book, The God Who Stays. Some of you might not realize, but I actually have a nonprofit ministry called Pop Wee, P-O-P-W-E. And we have a website, popwee.org. So you can go there and find out more about what we do. It's one of the resources that, it's just a way for us to, you know, I've always had it on my heart to do more than just make music for you guys, but I want to do life with you. That's why I do this podcast as well, just hoping to always find ways to encourage you wherever you're at in your story. And so our ministry does a lot of really cool things. We've got an amazing prayer network, people lifting you up if you've got a prayer request. We've got a way for you to share your story, be an encouragement to other people. You can sign up to receive a free weekly email devotional that I write. Some of those devotions I share on this podcast as well. But one of the other things that our podcast or that our ministry does is we make sure we try to get my book into places where normally people might not have access to it. And so we had shipped a couple of boxes of The God Who Stays to the inmates, and the inmates were coming up to me as I was hugging them and shaking their hand, and they had my book, and they were asking me questions. Like, chapter one in the book talks about my interaction with an Uber driver named Arthur who was listening to my song, The God Who Stays, and one of the inmates goes, hey, did you ever reconnect with Arthur? Did he ever know that he made it in your book? And man, it was so awesome to have that type of interaction. It was just, I don't know, it just fired me up, you know, and seeing those guys, you know, big tough guys in there wiping tears away from their eyes as we worship Jesus together. Just a really special thing. And I'm still kind of unpacking that experience. But, you know, sometimes I travel around the country and, you know, I'm obviously there for a concert, but sometimes it's all the things that happen on the way to the stage that God blows my mind, you know, and shows me that there's other reasons why I'm traveling, other reasons why I'm doing what I'm doing. Hopefully you can experience that as well. You know, the more we try to emulate following the life of Jesus, we realize that Jesus did a lot of his work on the way to destinations as well, right? He did a lot of his healing on the way, you know, where you thought he was headed to do the thing. He did the things along the way, on his way to do the thing. And so let us not get so fixated on the thing that we think we're going to do, and maybe be open to the fact that there are other things that God might have us do on the way to do the thing that he has for us to do. How's that for a deep and poetic thought? But it was an incredible experience. So the other thing that was cool is, thanks to my friends at TBN, a lot of the inmates said that they'd watched my Ryman Auditorium special. So they're getting access to ministry and the gospel and encouragement behind bars. And aren't you thankful today that God never gives up on any of us? You know, a friend of mine who does prison ministry, he says he always goes up and he speaks to inmates. He says, hey, look, I'm no different than any of you. The only difference between us is that you guys got caught and I didn't. That's his way of like leveling the playing field, you know, just realizing that, hey, we're all sinners, you know, and the wages of sin is death. There are consequences to our sin, but the gift of God and the gift of His grace is eternal life. So I had to share that beautiful experience with you guys. Heading into spring break, did a few less concerts in order to spend time with my girls on spring break, enjoying that time together, but wanted to make sure I'm still coming to you with the podcast today. And I'd love to share a devotion that I hope will set the table as we head towards the Easter season. My mom was talking with me, and she shared a really cool thought about Jesus' choice of transportation on that Palm Sunday when he rode into town. And I want to share this with you today. I want to talk to you about a humble king and a humble donkey. First, I have to tell you this. The other day, I saw this guy pull up at valet parking outside of a restaurant. He had this rare exotic sports car. I mean, bright red, you know, candy apple. Perfectly polished. I mean, this thing probably had to be $200,000 car. I mean, it was insane, you know. It was the kind of car that made everybody, you know, including me, stop and stare. You know, you just kind of, you're looking like, man, looking at the car. You're trying to get a glimpse of, you know, who's behind the wheel. You're wondering what kind of job they had that they could afford such an expensive car. You know what I mean? It was that kind of thing. This guy was arriving in style. Of course, it made me laugh because I was thinking to myself as I'm watching this guy pull up. For some reason, the image of my first car popped into my head. Back in college, I saved up $800 to buy, you ready for this? It was a 1988 blue Honda Prelude SI stick shift. I didn't even drive stick shift. So I had to learn how to drive stick shift in order to drive the car that I had just bought. It already had 200,000 miles on it. It was, you know, it was well maintained, but it was already on its last leg. It was a far cry from a luxury vehicle. Let's just say I wasn't turning any heads with my mode of transportation, you know. You can think about it, like, you want to arrive in style, but in those early days, not, you know, I'd never have been like a sports car kind of guy, you know, even if I could afford one, I'm not sure that's what I would do. But you do get self-conscious, right? I'm not sure what kind of car you drive up in, but have you ever had that moment where you're like embarrassed of what you're driving compared to the dude with the polished Ferrari or whatever? But, you know, here's one of the things I was thinking about. Speaking of transportation, have you ever noticed Jesus' choice of transportation for his arrival into Jerusalem? He knew that all eyes were going to be on him. And he could have ridden into town on a majestic white horse, right? He could have made a grand entrance by being carried by some royal chariot. I mean, he could have arrived in style. A king could choose his mode of transportation. He could have done that. He could have made a grand entrance by being carried like that. He could have done any of that. But instead, what did he do? He chose a donkey. He rode into Jerusalem on a humble donkey. A humble king chose the humblest means of transportation. Now, he knew that many in the crowd had the wrong idea about his royalty. I think this is so significant why he did this. They hailed him as king, but expected him to seize the throne in Jerusalem, not realizing that God's kingdom, that his kingdom was not on earth. So why a donkey? Well, back then, a donkey was the choice of the common man. And here's the thing, it wasn't even his donkey. So he was riding into town on a donkey he didn't even own. It was a loaner. He had no saddle, so he used borrowed blankets. That's in Luke chapter 19. In other words, Jesus chose an old Honda over the fancy sports car, right? And the crowd's response? Well, they hailed this humble king with shouts of prayer and praise. They shouted, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." That's John chapter 12, verse 13. The Hebrew word for Hosanna is Hosiana. I think I'm saying that right. Correct me if I'm wrong. Now that means, save us, we pray. Hosanna, save us, we pray. For Christ followers, the goal is to be more and more like Jesus each day, right? That's the message of the My Story, Your Glory devotional, is every day just saying, Lord, make me more like you. I want my story to bring you glory. Now, as we look at the life of Jesus, it's so amazing to discover that there is something to be learned from every step he took, or in this case, every ride, every choice he made, every word he spoke. Today, I want you to consider what we can learn from Jesus' choice to ride a donkey into Jerusalem. Here's one thing the Lord is showing me through that story. A humble heart is what pleases him. You know, I read an article that said most people who buy a luxury vehicle, they could fall in the category of being quote-unquote status seekers. Jesus was not a status seeker. A humble heart is what pleases God. Jesus knows that, and he wanted to display that then and to us now. We are not to live our lives as status seekers. Isn't that hard to remember, though? Always trying to turn the heads of the world or impress the crowd. Tell me if you've ever been guilty of that. I know I have. I'm in front of a crowd so many nights, and it's hard not to fight that temptation to have the attention on me. As we enter this Easter season, I want to invite you to join me in preparing all of our hearts and asking God to make us more like him in humility. Let this be our anthem. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. As we pray Hosanna, we can say, save us, we pray. God, save us from arrogance. Save us from being overly concerned about our outward appearance. Save us from our tendency to try to be status seekers. Save us from the desire to impress and flash, and help us to realize, just like Jesus was setting the tone, he was setting the standard for humility, for servanthood. A humble king is leading us in the way of humility too. And that's something that challenges me today, and I hope it challenges you as well. We can learn as we head towards the Easter season and be mindful and thankful for a humble king who chose a humble donkey. Amen. Hey, let me pray for you today before we head on our way. Thank you for listening to me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love. Thank you for your word that we can read. And if our eyes are open, if our hearts are open, there's so much for us to learn from your truth and from the example that you set throughout Scripture. I pray for anybody listening to this today. I pray that what we've shared has been an encouragement. I pray for the inmates back in Pennsylvania who asked me. They said, keep praying for us. So I'm praying for them right now. Lord, meet them where they are behind those bars. May they know that there's hope. And anybody who's not in prison, but maybe feeling like they're in a prison of their own making, Lord, I pray that we can all be reminded that freedom is what you call us to. Freedom is what you offer us. Freedom through your grace, your forgiveness, and the gift of a second chance. Lord, help us to live a life of humility, not to be a status seeker, but to live our lives in such a way, not pointing the attention to us, but pointing the attention to you. May others see us and see you in us more than us trying to impress. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for listening today. Thank you for joining me. Make sure that you go get a copy of the new book, My Story, Your Glory. Get it pre-ordered, then head over to MatthewWest.com, redeem your order so you can get access to the launch party on March 19th. Okay, my friends? Now go make the most of the one shot you get at life. It's your story for his glory. I'll see you next week.